The new way is wow. That's the answer. The new way is wow. I got a comment question. Why so fast? Well, because the new way is wow. Right, the new way is wow. And the new way is to where to prioritize our attention. Okay, what are we focusing on? We have to prioritize it. We can't just be all over the place. I know I've always wondered, why hasn't Jesus answered a lot of questions, like especially about Christianity? Because that's not his priority. He says, I don't want that to be your priority. You need to put your attention, try putting your attention here, because this is what's going to really save you. Okay. Now, he doesn't say save you from what, really, although he does indicate the general context that the ego is, you know, just hideous. And it certainly is. But if we don't know what we're being saved from, which is constant feeling of regret, constant feeling of being trapped, constant feeling of vulnerability, constant feeling of fear, dissatisfaction, instability, uncertainty, terror, dread, on and on and on and on. You know, just this ocean of hope and fear. That's what we're going to be saved from. And however this ocean of hope and fear plays out, okay, the remedy is still the same. So we don't really need to focus so much on what is happening in the world or how it's going to go. We know that the ocean is going to get very stormy, but the remedy is the same whether the ocean is choppy or really stormy, because a choppy ocean is just an ocean waiting to get really stormy, and it will come along soon enough. So we want to put our attention where it best suits us, okay? And that is on how to practice. So how to practice is really where to put our attention instead of, you know, what's going on in the world, what's going on anywhere, actually. Because the right practice will take care of it all. The new way practice will take care of it all. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised. And it's much better than expected. Wow. They say this is right practice. Stevia, zero calories, but it didn't taste very good. But zero calories is always good. And speaking of zero, I'm nothing. I'm absolutely nothing. I can't earn anything. I don't deserve anything. I don't deserve anything whatsoever, and I never will deserve anything whatsoever. I can't earn anything for myself. I can't do anything for myself. I'm totally incapable of anything. Totally incapable of anything. So as we flatten, as we devalue the I, as we devalue the I, and we stick with this practice, what happens is our consciousness, our frame of reference shifts for our attention into what I call mandalic consciousness, holistic consciousness. Anybody say, "Oh, I see it differently now. Isn't that amazing?" Okay, so the attention, we have to devalue the I. Right now, attention thinks that it's fixated as an I, and when we keep devaluing the I, say it's worthless. It will never have any worth, no value, whatever. The attention sort of says, wow, I don't really want to be that, you know, and then it enables it to shift and say, oh, I've never been that. In fact, I never can be an I. I never can be fixated. How about that? So that's the right way to practice, and that's what we're doing, and it's always a great time to go as fast as possible, all right? Always a great time. The progress should always be brisk. We should always be looking to push the pace, but just not absurdly so. In mandalic consciousness, that rattles the cage of the ego, for sure, because I've gotten backlash today that I've never experienced before in my life. It's a very coordinated backlash, very, very cleverly done. And it kind of like, I just have to say wow to it. The mind is indeed quite awake and quite clever in protecting its pretension that it's not awake. So the mind is totally awake and totally diligent about protecting its pretension that it's not awake. Get that. Hallelujah. It's like, wow. Yeah, it's a, I say, how can the mind be so clever in setting me up for a fall, which is what it is doing, trying to do. And it's amazing how it's reinforced for this person, this person, this situation. I say, wait, and but also the Holy Spirit's warning me and saying, your mind is trying to set you up. The one mind is trying to set you up for a fall because you are shifting into mandala consciousness, and it doesn't want that. So it's trying to buy me off and say, hey, wouldn't you like this? Wouldn't you like, you know, it's trying to bribe me out of mandala consciousness. And at the same time, in such a manner that I'm put in a place where I'm bound to fail and meet my demise. Even though it's trying to make it like the most attractive situation in the world. And it's like, wow, how can the mind be so awake to its defenses? If it's asleep, how could it be so awake like this? Obviously, it's not asleep. This just proves it. It is not asleep at all. I mean, the mind is super duper active in defending its ridiculous pretension that it's not awake. And so I must have really, the latest video, last one, really rattled the cage ever since I shifted into mandala consciousness. The videos have been so profound that the mind is alarmed, you know, very alarmed. And it comes at you not in a negative way, but it tries to give you something like, you know, you've always dreamed of, oh, the dream situation. It's like unbelievably great. Oh, this is so nice. Oh, and I'm being, you know, it's like a miracle. It looks like, you know, the universe is moving me into some really wonderful place. I'm so important and all this stuff. But in the back of your mind, you say, wait a minute, you know, so many warning signs popped up. So many warning signs popped up. And it's basically say, if you only work on fixing the problem, we'll make you like one of the VIPs of the world. That's what I was offered. The mind, the one mind, basically let me know that if I committed to trying to fix the problem, that I would be treated like a super VIP. Live in the best place in the world, you know, with all the other super VIPs and you know, just all of this. And of course, this is the ego, okay? Because the whole delusion is that there's something to fix. That is the delusion. So the ego says, if you only help us fix the problem, then, you know, you're going to just be treated like, you know, live in a mansion. Well, who wants to live in a mansion? I sure don't. Just give me something simple. Just give me clarity and something really simple. So, it was very alarming to see the extent, you know, the ego tries to bribe you. Tries to bribe you. No question about it. So, look out for that. Look out for that. It says, I have an idea of what I want, and it's trying to give me something way better than that. Like, you know, oh, that's what you want. That's not important enough for you. We're going to put you in where the most important people in the world are. Come on, you're right up there. We know you are, and we know you can really help us fix the world, fix the problem. You know, something's not working right. We need to fix it. And so, wow, very alarming and wowish. You know, very wowish to see. Gee. And to know that many, you know, succumb to that because they don't know how to practice. They don't have the confidence they can get anything better. So they think, well, this is the best I can do. I can commit to trying to fix some problem. Well, what's the problem we're really trying to fix here? We're really trying to get God to the negotiating table. Okay. All right. Of course, God can never go to any negotiating table because God knows everything is perfect. There's nothing amiss to negotiate about at all. But what we're trying to do is we're trying to be greater than God, and we're trying to get God. We're going to say, God, we know we fixated the mind. Okay, we figured out how to do it, but we're just going to tell you, you know what? We love you so much that we're going to unfixate it for you. But the price of us unfixating it is you have to read to worship us as the prime creator, and now you're the prime created. Okay, we've reversed positions with you, God. So this is what we've been aiming at. Spirit has been aiming at this, to be greater than God. And so the problem that really we want fixed is we want to get God to the negotiating table. And how do we do that? Well, we think we can do that by making this world such a beautiful, peaceful place. We'll say, God, look, fixation of the mind isn't the problem at all. I mean, look how beautiful and happy we are here, you know. So you'll be just that. You'll be really happy and wonderful and beautiful too when we come to terms. And we'll unfixate it just to show you, you know, our goodwill. But you have to do what we tell you to do, or we can fixate again. But don't worry, you know, don't worry. It's good both ways. It's good both ways, both fixated and unfixated. It's good both ways. And we're just proving that to you in good faith, showing you, look, we're really good people, be nice people, and fixation isn't bad. God, look how happy the world is. So this whole idea of turning this world into a world of peace, a world of prosperity, bring the kingdom of heaven to earth and all this stuff, is really the attempt to bring God to the negotiating table. Because the fact is, everything's already perfect. The mind has never been fixated. Our attention has never fixated at all. Everything is already paradise. Everything is the heart of everything. It's already that. It never stopped being that. So this whole notion of the kingdom of heaven on earth, bringing peace to earth, we need to fix the problems of the world, that's a total scam from spirit that is trying to convince God to negotiate. Say, hey, look, we're worth negotiating with. You know, we're good people. You know, God, look how prosperous we are. Look how we're able to, you know, thrive. And so we're not going to give you a bad deal. Come on, we have nothing but goodness to give you, God. So we're trying desperately to eliminate all the problems because we think maybe God doesn't trust us. You know, all these wars and everything here. God says, You know, the spirit doesn't seem to be very, I don't really like what spirit has, you know, with a fixated mind. And I'm kind of worried that, you know, if I don't worship spirit right, that spirit may fixate the mind again. And then I'll have to deal with all this stuff. And I don't really like that, you know, so I don't want to come to the negotiating table. That's what we think, you know, that's what we think. And it's funny. We need to have some humor about it, but it's absolutely true. That's why we're so desperately trying to fix the world when in fact we can just pivot our attention and recognize there's really no world at all. There's no world of fixation at all. Attention can't fixate. Okay, so not only can we not fixate attention, obviously we also can't unfixate it. And so also trying to make this world a heavenly place is showing God that we know how to unfixate the mind. I said, God, we fixated attention, but now we're proving that we can unfixate so you can trust us. You can trust us. And just letting you know that we have the power over you now. We can both fixate and unfixate. We know unfixating it proves to you that we actually fixate it because we know how to undo what we did. And so I guess undoing the fixation would be for this world to become a wonderful, nice, you know, paradise, utopia here. And everybody would stroll around with a smile on their face. So, I was offered to go to some worldly utopia where everybody strolls around with smiles on their face and is so wealthy and happy. And say, be a model citizen for God. Say, God, look how happy Clarity Ross is. I mean, you know, he's really been able to undo the mental fixation. And so you can trust that this happens here in the world, you know. And we take credit for that. Of course, this is total dualistic delusion. So, non-dual teaching is that the mind has never been fixated, and in fact there's no fixation to undo. Okay, there's no fixation to undo, and that's what rattles the ego's cage. It rattles the entire scheme. The entire scheme has been brought to light here. Now it's been raised to the light, into the light, and we say, holy cow, wow, But of course, this does set off alarm bells throughout the one mind that is attempting to spirit in the one mind, as the one mind is attempting to take over the position of prime creator. And it's the ridiculousness of its scheme is being brought to light. So it tries to, plug the leak, plug the leak. And if it did it in a negative way, I would immediately, say, "Hey, what's going on?" So instead, it tries to do it in a really positive way, like offer you something really great. That you could, it's like being unbelievably magnanimous, like to reward you for what a great job you've done. We think you're wonderful. Here's this, benefit for that. We're working on it. We're gonna do miracles for you. Make sure you have this wonderful prize that is just exactly what you need." And all this, I say, well, on the surface it seems pretty nice, but if you dig a little deeper, it's terrible. It's like this white bread I had today. It's titled as the world's greatest white bread. It's the world's worst white bread, actually. It looks great, and then you toast it and say, "Oh my, this is great." And you bite into it, and instead of being kind of crunchy and chewy, all the bread compresses down into a very thin, super dense layer, super dense. It really, but and so. It's like eating like it's hard to describe. It's horrible. Horrible. It gets real slippery and dense. All the air in the bread gets goes disappears and compacts into just this gooey, really really dense gooey substance that you're eating. And this is touted as, Dave's white bread, best white bread. Man, it's the worst bread I've ever had. We're gonna throw it away. It's just horrible. I had it for a sandwich, and I've had it before. I just can't believe how terrible it is. So something on the surface may look and its packaging as the world's greatest white bread. I said, "Wow, this is awesome. Organic, everything." And it turns out it's the worst. It's the worst. So it's kind of like that. That marketing can make us seem like something's just absolutely great on the surface, and we can't believe it could be so bad. But actually, underneath, you'll find out it's absolutely terrible. Absolutely terrible. Oftentimes, really wealthy people in certain areas, they just suicide, which is the whole purpose of putting you there. Just terrible. It's the surface. You think that everything's great, but it's not. It's really not. The vibe is wrong. There's something, that isn't right for you. Just not right. Maybe they're thinking that the deal that they made, deal with the devil, of fixing, fixing this world and being trying to represent the world as someone who's fixed, someone who's, look, unfixated my attention. And look how happy I am. I unfixated my attention. Okay, so that's the ego's spirituality. Is the ego says we're working on unfixating your attention, and when we do, this world's going to be, a glorious place. It's a new age where everybody's working on healing their mind, on unfixating their attention. This is the ego. That's totally the ego. That's totally a scam. Trying to scam God into believing that we fixated the attention. Okay. And then we unfixate it to prove to God that we have superior power to God. Say, "God, your creation, you thought it, mind couldn't be fixated. Well, we found a way to fixate it, and we prove that to you by our goodwill by unfixating it." Okay, but we're going to now incorporate you, include you in the new creation. And if you just worship us as the prime creator, we won't fixate it. We won't do anything you don't like. But if you don't worship us properly, and we're not happy about it, we're going to fixate it again. Like that, laying down the rules to God, like that. The wind's calming down a little bit. Man, it's so windy every day here. Starts about 1:30 or so. It's just tremendous winds. I was thinking, maybe I could finally play golf. No, you're kidding. Winds like this are the golfer's worst nightmare. It makes the round just horrible. I'm not gonna go out there. I'm not a masochist. Not a sadist, not a masochist. Wow. Boy, did I get warnings from people. Holy cow. It's just, I cannot explain it, what happened, other than the mind is just extraordinary. You know, how it orchestrates everything. But in this case, Grace was simultaneously orchestrating warnings. So temptation is awful when you're tempted, and of course the mind hits you where the temptation is most effective. It knows exactly how to tempt you, tempt itself. You know, isn't that amazing? It knows exactly how to tempt itself in the most ruinous way, and it does it. That's why we think the mind is bad, you know. But it's just the mind afraid to recognize it's never been fixated, thinking that that's an abyss, terrified. So it defends against that. It defends against it. The mind can never lose its power. It's impossible. It can just, but it can use it in such a way as to seem to be very problematic to itself. So I don't know what's going to happen. It's really a shocker. That's why when you pioneer stuff like this, you know, you don't know what's going to happen. You don't know what's around the next bend. I never know. I never know what's around the next bend. So it's kind of fraught with a nervousness. All that glitters is not gold, that's for sure. All that glitters is not gold. So I just stick with my good habits and keep on practicing my good habits. Like that's what you need to do. Don't be in too much of a hurry. Don't be in too much of a hurry. I was thinking, I gotta play golf yesterday. I gotta play golf. I gotta do it. I said, wait a minute. Let me keep working on my swing here. And get more and more confident in what I can do, and you know, why try to hurry it? And I actually checked for a tee time. There wasn't any available. I said, wow, that's a sign right there, right? So keep on practicing. You know, keep on stick with what works. Stick with what works. But yeah, I can tell you that. The events have been quite shocking. Quite alarming. Alarm bells really sounding. Yeah. But, you know, we just have to be patient with it. Stay calm. But there are, you will feel at times, you will feel, wow. I feel kind of a little bit alarmed. The ego doesn't want me to continue, doesn't want me to keep going. and then you're not sure. Well, maybe it's helpful for me, or maybe it's not helpful for me. But then you get a lot of signs, you know, that that's not what I really want to do. You know, it just so many different signs. Like I said, the packaging, the white bread looked great, but it turns out to be just so hideous, I never want to touch it again. That kind of thing. I was already in that area once in my life, and it was the worst time of my life. It was, almost died there. It was horrible. Even though it seems like everyone should be happy there, I wasn't. You know, and so the ego says, "Hey, maybe I can, you know, fooled you once, maybe I can fool you twice." It's that kind of thing. I didn't listen to my intuition the first time, and I did, but I was too pressured. You know, I think you got to do this, you got to do this. That's everybody. Da 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 da. So this practice, like, I have no importance. It's very, very important. And my Christian friend, told me today. I said, "What's the word?" And he told me exactly that. He says, "Left to my own demise, you know, of myself, I can do nothing. But of God, all things are possible." So we need to really devalue the I of myself. I have no importance whatsoever. I'm forever totally unimportant. I don't deserve anything. I don't have the importance to deserve anything. I don't have the importance to deserve anything. And the only help I ever want is from the Dharma. If I can further the Dharma in any way, fine. But other than that, you know, I can't do anything at all. I have no desire to do anything at all. So let the Dharma kings decide where we go and what we do. Otherwise, I'm incapable of doing anything. Without their guidance, I'm incapable of making any choice whatsoever, making any decision. I can't think for myself. I can't choose for myself. I'm incapable of thinking. I'm incapable of choosing. I'm incapable of doing anything at all. I'm incapable of moving anywhere, going anywhere. I can't go anywhere. I can't even be anywhere. I'm incapable of appreciating anything. I can't appreciate anything. So don't dangle some utopia in front of me, because I'm incapable of appreciating anything. I'm not important enough to appreciate, to have anything to appreciate, actually. So lower yourself, constantly lower yourself. The I self, the belief that there's a fixated self, that there's attention is fixated into a self, an I. Constantly lower that in your valuing. Devalue it, devalue it, devalue it. I have no rights at all. I don't have the right to be happy at all. I'll never have any rights. I don't deserve anything. I'll never deserve anything. I can't have anything at all. I'm not important enough to have anything. I'm really not important enough to have anything at all. I have zero importance, so I don't have the importance to have anything at all. I don't have the importance to have any situation whatsoever. Now, pragmatically, in this world, quote unquote, as we're working to help others, it'll seem like we might be somewhere, or have something, or some circumstance. But that's totally up to the Dharma kings, based on how to further the Dharma. It's not coming from I at all. I don't have anything at all. I don't even have any circumstances at all. I'm not important. I don't have the importance to have any circumstances. I don't have the importance to be anywhere. I don't have the importance to be given anything. I don't have the importance to be helped in any way. So I see now this really, really hits hard. I can feel it. This is called right practice. See, the ego doesn't expect us to practice this way. This is how it keeps control over us. It's through self-importance. And my Christian friend today, he was great. He was right on point. He talked about self-importance. He says, you know, be humble. We don't have any. By myself, I'll be left to my own demise. Absolutely. I can't do anything right at all. And he says, why worry when you can pray? Why worry when you can pray? Right. And the prayer should just be the grace of God is already shining upon me as promised. And it's better than expected. Wow. The grace of God, the holy light of the grace of God, the most holy light, of the grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. Vastly better than expected. Wow. Now, at first, we might say it's shining upon me, and perhaps later, ultimately, we might say it's shining as me, you know, shining as me. But first, we'll say shining upon me. But it can only be seen when we devalue the notion of a fixated attention. So, I am of no consequence whatsoever. I've literally had no impact on this world, I've had no impact on anything at all. And I never will have any impact on anything at all. I've set no example whatsoever. I can never set even the slightest example of anything. I'm completely useless. Absolutely useless in every regard. I am absolutely useless in every regard. So this is the new way practice. The practice that the ego frantically tries to prevent us from practicing. Which is why it's so rarely practiced. The ego succeeded in preventing me from practicing this way for 48 years, despite my very best efforts. Right? It says if you do that, you're going to die. You're going to go crazy. You know, you're going to be annihilated. Annihilated? I'm not important enough to be annihilated. What are you talking about? I can't be annihilated. I have no importance. You have to be very important to be annihilated. I have no importance. I can't be annihilated. Fall into abyss? Again, I have zero importance. Only the very important can fall into an abyss. So I can never fall into any abyss. I have no importance. Die? I have no importance to die. I have to be super important to die. Got to be a VIP to die. But I have zero importance, so I can't possibly die. And the ego says, but yeah, but that's proven to God that we can undo the fixation, the mental fixation. You got to help us out here. Come on. I say, I don't have any importance to help. I'll never be able to help anyone. I'm incapable of helping any cause at all. I cannot help any cause whatsoever. I'm incapable of that. Why? I have zero importance. I have no importance whatsoever. And again, this is not an ideology. This is a practice, right? It's a practice. I cannot be an example of anything. I'm just a zero. I'm total zero. I have zero importance. How can I have importance to be an example of something? I can never be an example of anything at all. I can never be an exemplar of anything in any regard. Good, bad, you name it. I'm just a complete zero. I'm not even an example of that. A zero can't be an example of itself. You know, keep that in mind. Absolute zero. Not important enough to suffer. Not important enough to have troubles. Not important enough to help out any crusade whatsoever, any cause at all. I'm incapable of helping any cause at all. I'm always a zero. So this is really causing a nervous reaction, a deep a core reaction for sure. Calm down. Maybe if I golf some other time, I don't know. But I just don't feel like it yet. It just, you know, everything has to, just you can't force it. So just keep working out, keep doing your practice, just keep doing what you're doing. Don't worry about some sensational offer or something. The Dharma Kings want you somewhere. They will, it'll feel like there's this inevitability and it feels right. Whereas if the ego is trying to entrap you, it will feel like you have to, it feels like, you won't feel right about it, like you have to do all this work, and you have to fix all this stuff. It's just, it doesn't quite feel right to you, really. You feel panicky, a little panicky, not quite right about it. Whereas when the Dharma Kings want you to do something, I feel like, you know what, I know this is going to happen, no doubt about it, and so I'm going to work towards it and get ready and prepare like that. Whereas this, it doesn't feel that way. It feels like I'm going to my demise. But I'm not important enough to go to my demise. I can never go to my demise. I'm incapable of going to my demise. I have no importance. How can zero go to zero? How can zero go to zero? How can zero go to zero? The holy light of God's grace is shining upon me, already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow, wow, wow. The holy light of God's grace is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow, wow, wow. The holy light of God's grace is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow, wow, and wow. I can do nothing at all, and I need do nothing. There's nothing I need to do at all. There's absolutely nothing that I need do at all. I need do nothing at all. So this is the kind of practice that Jesus and the Dharma Kings advise us. Okay? Like this, like we're doing here. I need do nothing at all. There's nothing I need to do. There's nothing I'll ever need to do. And really, I can't do anything. If there's nothing to do, there's really nothing to do. So how can I do anything? It's impossible. And again, this is not an ideology. It's a practice. As soon as you try to twist this into an ideology, level confusion will arise for you. So this is a practice. And what does this practice result in? What we see is a frame of reference shift, okay, into what I just label as mandalic consciousness perspective, mandalic consciousness. But that's just a throwaway label. I mean, just refer to it some way. Don't try to fixate, oh, I got to look at mandalas now. So, no. It's not like that. It's this kind of consciousness where you have this overview and you see the scheme we've been engaged in of transmigration, of birth and death and fixation, all that is completely flat. And it's just been a play of attention, thinking that you were in that somehow, living there as an entity. Whereas you realize that never was the case. It was just something that you were using, device you were using to imagine that you could be fixated, attention could be fixated. And in other words, you realize you're never born. Nothing's ever been born. Nothing's ever been born. Even mothers have never been born. If mothers have never been born, how can they give birth? How can anything be born of mothers if the mothers themselves have never been born? We're just, our attention is playing with these shadows, so to speak, as if we had been born, but we've never been born. It's just a play of attention. And probably not that as sophisticated as we'd like to believe, or as complex. Probably very simple, actually. Jesus says it's very simple. Very, very simple. But we're certainly in the ego's kitchen right now. Really. And of course, you know, if you go into someone's kitchen when they're cooking, they don't like it. Right? The mad chef, you know, hell hath no fury like a chef who doesn't want you in their kitchen. Why is it that chefs are that way? They have a reputation for them being the most temperamental people in the world, don't they? Very strange. Very odd indeed. It's like life and death in there. It's like they're like captaining a ship, you know, and everything has to go right. If it doesn't go exactly right, you know, it's like the end of the world. How is that? It's just food. Who wants to eat your food anyway? I don't. It's gonna be a smoothie. I don't care about food. I'm not important enough to care about food. People try to cook, oh, this, there's some food. Really, I say, I don't really care. I don't even think about food. I get up in the morning, it's like, I can't even think of anything to eat. It's like, I have to have food? What a drag. You know, I'd rather just not even have to think about it at all. It's just a way to kill yourself, food, basically. Right? Yeah. Bring about your demise and say, you see, I was fixated. And the end of fixation proves that I was fixated. See that? You see, death, the end of fixation, apparent fixation, is the proof. Oh my gosh, I was fixated, you see? Because I've undone it now. I've undone the fixation. What a clever little trick, huh? We say, you see, God, I'm finally free again. I was able to undo the fixation of the body. But really, we're just on to the next play of attention that we claim as fixation. And then we work on undoing that also, which compulsively pushes into the next one, and the next one. And that's the wheel, this disc of transmigration, where you just wander through all these, undoing all these fixations. Or what are we doing in existence? Just a massive collective effort of undoing fixations to prove to God that we fixated the mind. But when we recognize the mind can't be fixated, we don't have to go through the charade of undoing all these fixations, do we? Poof, mandala consciousness, just like that. Oh, I see the entire realm of transmigration like a flat disc, and I just see the play of attention. I'm projecting my attention on it. Oh, it's okay. None of it is true. What a silly game. So again, the entire realm of condition, existence, the realm of impermanence, is nothing more than trying to prove to God that we were able to unfixate the mind, our attention, unfixate it. Which would, of course, prove that we fixated it in the first place, right? Hello? So everything, from the microbe to the insect to the mountain to everything, as it crumbles, as it decays, as it dies, everything dies, doesn't it? And we, for us, that's the proof that we unfixated all the fixation. See, this mountain god, what, millions and millions of years from now, it'll be worn away. It'll be, the fixation will be gone. And so we prove we have this, that we were able to unfixate it. Same with the tree, same with this, same with all of this. Everything meets its demise. It all becomes unfixated, God, and returns to you, the unfixated state. Of course, that is our way of trying to prove that it was fixated in the first place, which would mean we had changed reality, which means that we had power over God. So really, the entire realm of impermanence is really the attempt to reclaiming that we have power over God, plain and simple. This is our demonstration, the way we demonstrate that we have power over God. And we're just trying to get God to accept this. So we keep doing it. God hasn't accepted it yet. We say, gosh, you know, maybe if you meet, you know, maybe if Jesus meets his demise, God will finally accept that we are able to unfixate the body of Jesus. Unfixated. Yeah. That's just an example. But we're trying to, you know, keep thinking of, ultimately, God will have to recognize that our genius in unfixating, our great gift to God is unfixating all of this, showing how amazingly, how much we love God, and we don't want God to have a fixated mind. So we're proving to God just how skillful and determined we are to unfixate all fixations of the mind that arise. And so, you know, it hasn't worked yet, but, you know, God's a tough customer, tough sell. Maybe if we go on and die a billion more deaths, God will finally say, oh, yes, indeed. You really, really, really have managed to unfixate everything, haven't you? That's about all it's worth, is just a chuckle, right? That's exactly what's going on. So, this is a little better than talking about politics, isn't it? Absolutely it is. Absolutely it is. See, everybody's out there screaming and protesting and politicking like crazy on all sides, right? It's a massive distraction. Because what we could be doing is what we're doing right here, when we're proving that we can do this, if we just decide to do it. If we just decide to do it, right? We can see and recognize death. Oh, so that's what it's all about. How easy now to let it go. How easy to be untroubled by it. The mind has never been fixated, so there's actually no possibility we could ever go through a process of being unfixated. Yeah. So this helps us shift our frame of reference. The frame of reference shift into Mandalic consciousness. I like that. Mandalic consciousness. Wow. But yeah, it hits our nerves. You know, we're getting down to it now that we're really pushing through. And Jesus says death is the last to go, the last obstacle to go. Well, it just went. And it just went. It just went the way of the dodo bird here. And of course, this is all going out to the collective consciousness. Not just those who are viewing this, but the collective consciousness. So this information is now in the collective consciousness. And everybody gets this like, oh my gosh. Yeah. If we see it that way, it's like, holy cow. It's just good for a laugh. Oh my gosh. So that's how we've been doing all along. Since nothing's fixated in the first place, we really don't have to don't have to try and unfixate anything, really. I mean, nothing is real fixation at all. This body's not real fixation. It's just imagination, intrinsic space just decorating itself. There's no fixation. So, certainly we don't need to try and unfixate it, right? Since the jig is up, you know. We don't have to try and unfixate anything. Finish with that. Give it up. We realize what the scam is. Now, we're not going to chase down the ramifications of this. We just wow it. All right, just wow it. That's what enables us to make such great progress. We don't bother with the ramifications. They'll happen on their own. Whatever ramifications will arise automatically. We don't have to catalog them or name them or label them or chase them down. We just keep our response singular. We just say, wow, singular response. 4th of July is at hand. 4th of July in the United States is at hand. And people are, you know, doing what they've always done, distracting themselves. They're not doing what we're doing, are they? That's for sure. Distracting themselves. People tell me, why don't you go play golf? Why don't you? Well, because I'd rather recognize the complete scam of what death is about. You know, and be done with it once and for all, then play golf. You know, I'll play golf a little later. But it's better when you're on a roll. Keep, you know, stay on a roll. Stay on a roll. So God doesn't recognize any fixations at all. So certainly God doesn't recognize any unfixations either. So all death has been entirely in vain, hasn't it? Absolutely. And really nothing's ever died because nothing's ever been fixated in the first place. There's never been any death at all. We don't try to figure this out. We just have faith that you know, the ramifications will dawn upon us. Mandalic consciousness will become more and more clear. On its own accord, we just do the work. We just do our part and let the Holy Spirit do its part. We just practice like this and do our little, you know, little part, and the rest will let the rest take care of itself. My swing is good. Golf swing's good. I'm working on my irons and swinging them all good. It's just all about putting a charge into them. Which I have not been doing before. I just simply wasn't putting a charge into them. You gotta do a turn. You gotta do a shoulder turn. You gotta get behind it, and then really, you know, come through and put a charge into the ball. Otherwise, it won't compress and it won't go anywhere. It's all about compression there. And now, I used to be using a super low compression ball, and actually, then the ball did fly pretty nicely I didn't swing very hard. But of course, if you do swing hard, then it you know, it's hard to control the yardage. But those balls in the summertime, when you really hit your driver hard, they're a little too soft. I believe you lose a lot of yardage. Actually, it's better to have a much harder higher compression, harder ball in the summer when it's hot and things tend to expand and be a little looser, not contract and turn into like a rock. And if you're swinging real hard, then it's better to have that. It can handle the higher compression, can handle a higher swing speed, and not over compress. So I'm in good enough shape to put a charge into the ball. Like I used to. Which was fun. It was a lot funner back then. I'm thinking back about it when I was younger. Golf was fun, but why? Because I hit the ball hard. And recently, you know, it hasn't been fun because it's too weak. You know, part of the fun is just hitting the ball hard and watching it fly. Wherever it flies, it, you know, if it hits a tree, it hits a tree hard. If it goes out of bounds, it goes way out of bounds. I mean, you know, big stuff happens when you hit the golf ball hard. And there's lots of laughs, and it's funner than if you're just kind of weakly, you know, hitting it and just feeble kind of, not to really, it's not meant to, golf's not really meant to be played that way. You want to have fun out there, you know, put a charge into the ball, see where it ends up. You never know where it may end up. Even if it goes too far, you know, and disappears in the bushes, down in the creek or something, you could say, "Wow, I hit that 20 yards further than I thought I would. That was amazing. That was amazing." So you don't feel bad. You just say, "Holy cow, I really put a tremendous charge in that ball. You know, that was fun. Really, that ball just flew like a bat out of hell. That's amazing." You say, "Oh well, you know, you don't feel so bad." But if you just hit it feebly and something bad happens, then you just really get mad. You smash your driver and it goes in the lake and you say, "Holy cow, I didn't know I could hit it that far. That's amazing. I thought it'd be short." No, I wasn't short. I went into the water. Well, I really crushed that one. So you don't care. It's like, "Oh well, you know, I'm getting my fun's worth here." Yeah. People, of course, they love that, to watch a golfer like that. Used to love Arnold Palmer. You know, he just absolutely went for it so aggressively. You know, I just wailed on it, and it was so exciting. Everybody said, "What's he going to do with this shot? What's going to happen to this shot?" You know, it was amazing. He had a whole army. He had millions and millions of fans. Like the super dynamic, aggressive, powerful way that he would hit the ball and take on any challenge, like, you know, and dare to, you know, "I'm going to try this, dare this." Other golfers, you know, real power golfers, people love to see it. You know, what, you know, Jack Nicklaus, he's hitting a one iron. Are you kidding me? What's going to happen? Oh my gosh, he smashed that to the moon. And what's going to happen to it? I don't know. And other power golfers, Greg Norman was fun to watch. He always would take on the challenge. Phil Mickelson, John Daly. I think one of everybody's favorite golfers is John Daly because he took it to the max. They said, "John, what are you doing? The hole is a dog leg right, and you're aiming sideways off the tee, and you're actually aiming at a lake." He says, "Yeah, I know." He says, "You're not trying to hit the green. You're not trying to go over the lake and hit the green. You gotta carry the ball like 340 yards in the air." He says, "Yeah, I am trying to do that." And he says, "Well, you're crazy. You're going to the lake." Everybody's screaming, "Come on!" Yeah. Then bam, and he hits it, and it's just like ah, and the ball's just hanging out there forever. And of course, everybody's saying, "Go, go, 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 go! Come on!" What he did, yeah, he made it. Sometimes, I think one time he hit seven balls in the lake, one after the other, trying to go for it. And I don't know if the eighth one he finally made it, or he finally decided that's enough, or he may have walked off the golf course at that point. You gotta love that, you gotta love that, with millions of dollars on the line, and he's put seven balls in the water, just because he's not gonna lay up, and then walks off the course. Gets fined. So he was the ultimate in just, you didn't know what he would could do, and he wouldn't, over these trees, over this lake, and whatever, he's gonna go for it. It's like, holy cow. It's just unbelievable power like that. Because that's what we all want to do. We all want to be able to go out there and hit the ball over the lake. That's a great feeling, hitting the ball over a lake. Yep. Because you can't always judge the distance of the lake, and if you mishit it, you know it's in the water, and but you just feel like, I just want to go for it. It kind of is like you cheated death, right? I can get over this. But here, we didn't even cheat death. Okay, we realized we don't even need to cheat death anymore. Because we realize it's all just a complete fraud. Absolute fraud. And when we realize it's a fraud, we can have a little laugh. And that should be it. Of course, our expectations need to kind of coalesce around that. The results may not be instantaneous here because of our expectations. We say, "Whoa, wait a minute. Let me adjust to that. Let me adjust to that." But once we see it clearly, as we have in this video, then you just go into the wow. You don't try to grasp it. You don't try to chase down the ramifications. You don't try to chase down results. Don't chase after results. Refuse to chase after results. This is the skill in practicing. Refuse to chase after any results. Just bring it to light, and then that's good enough. Don't chase after results. They will be there when you're ready for it, when your expectations are ready for it. Don't chase after any results at all. I used to hit the ball really high at times, and that was fun. Like approach shot, 120-yard approach shot or something, and you just absolutely hit that thing to the moon, and you don't know where it's going to come down. But if it comes down near the pin, it feels like an unbelievable, like the satellite has come to Earth. And you brought it in the right place, the right landing spot. You're like an astronaut. So that adds a lot of value to just the fun of the game, rather than just hitting kind of a meek kind of lowly shot that just kind of goes and boom, boom, boom on the green. It's like, just pitching it on the green. What's that? Grip it and rip it and put the backspin on it and absolutely put it up in the air so it's up there with the birds. As if it will never come down. I don't know if I'd be able to do that. I'm not sure, how I was able to do that, but there are times I've been able to do that. And I guess the key is to have value in it, in every one of your shots, as we're kind of cooling down here from our awesome outing of death, right? Because you might think, well, I have fun, I'm just going to smash the driver as hard as I can off every hole. Well, if you do that, obviously you're going to get in a lot of trouble, which isn't, always the best idea. Kind of wears you out a little bit. There's something to be said landing something on the fairway, which is also fun. It shows you brought it in correctly. But if you can just absolutely mash your two hybrid, just high, majestic, just absolutely clobber it. That's a beautiful shot too. And that'll come down, and it won't be, you won't hit it too far. You won't be, a lot of shots, if you can hit it too far, you go into really bad trouble. So you're not just meekly laying up, you're clobbering it, but it's going the right distance. So you can still have fun with every shot and still play safe. You can have it both ways. So that's what I'm really working on, in terms of having fun, but also playing it safe, doing the right thing, not being reckless. So what golfers don't like, you're playing, is you take a club and just kind of half swing at it and like poop, line it down the middle, and it's a nice safe shot, kind of rolling, rolling, rolling. Okay, it's like, you're not entertaining us. That's not entertaining at all. Come on. What we like to see is that we're playing with someone that they just, crush it. The trajectory, I mean, just like a rocket taking off, or a jet airliner, a private jet is just roaring down the fairway and just takes off. It is wow. And we want to see these beautiful trajectories and shots. So, it's possible. I can do that. It's possible. But we don't want to get in a situation where we're making really stupid, we're doing, stupid things. We don't want to do stupid things, reckless stuff, unwise, troublesome, go against the obvious, stuff like that. Put it in the fairway, in the right place, but do it majestically. There you go. That's the style I was looking for. Put it in the fairway, but do it majestically. And following the pro golfers around, that's what you want to see. You have to hit a hybrid. They hit it so beautifully, majestically. It's like, oh my, what a beautiful shot. Holy cow, it sounded great. And it's just drilled out. They just drilled it out there. And it's just floating, floating, floating. Say, oh, that's how I want to hit it. Beautiful. But they only hit it like, they may hit it like 250 or something, 240, right in the middle of the fairway on a short hole, but with really tricky landing area. So they stayed out of trouble. They hit a driver, tried to drive the green or something, they're going to be in huge trouble. Stuff like that. They just hit it. They play safe, but still beautifully. So we can do that, right? We can do that. We can play safe here and still be beautiful, right? Absolutely. Still be majestic, beautiful, majestic, and at the same time, play it safe, play it the right way, play it the way the Holy Spirit wants us to play it. I remember it was like Sergio Garcia. I was sitting right behind him at this W World Golf W GC Championship, and great ball striker Sergio Garcia, and he took out, I think this like one iron or two iron. It was an iron off the tee. I was like, "What are you doing?" Everybody else was pounding their driver, and then he hit it. Oh my gosh. How did he manage? How does a small guy like that manage to hit a golf ball like that? I don't know. but it just sounded like a rifle shot, and the ball took off. It was just unbelievably perfect trajectory, and just, I don't know how far I hit that ball, but it was way, way, way out there, like a drive. It was just one of the most beautiful shots I've ever seen. It was just amazing to be right behind him when he hit that and to hear it. And I said, "Wow, how's that possible? You know, how is that really possible? I don't know. Those people are like supernatural or something." But he played it safe. You know, he said, "I know I can hit this iron in the fairway, and the rough is really nasty here. It gives me a good chance at birdie. Or if I go in the rough, I probably won't get birdie. So even if I get, you know, more yardage and go in the heavy rough with a driver, it's better to be in the fairway and not quite as far out there." But he still hit this aesthetically, you know, gorgeous shot. So I didn't feel cheated at all. I didn't feel cheated at all. I think Vijay Singh hit a driver there, and he mashed it. Absolutely mashed it. I don't know how they do it. I'm working on it, but boy, do they know how to coordinate everything so that the club just accelerates just at the right instant somehow. It all looks fluid, and they're not even swinging hard, but it's like cracking a whip or something, and it's just. But it's so fluid how they do it that you don't even see the power of speed. So it seems like supernatural what they do. It really does. Maybe that's why we enjoy watching them. Somebody, it's amazing. We said, no mere mortal could hit it like that. I mean, it has to be supernatural. But it is really the great coordination and timing that they have. I played with someone like that, real small guy, short, small, back in the Persimmon Club days, wooden, you know, Persimmon drivers, and he hit the ball out of sight. I'd never seen anyone hit the ball so well. And we were just like, our mouths were like, "Well, how are you?" Finally, I said, how did you do that?" I think at the end of the round, "How did you?" He said, "I don't know." I said, "I've never hit the ball so well. I haven't." But I didn't believe him. Of course, he says that every time. Like, "I don't know what happened this round. You know, it was just like amazing. I never hit the ball like that before." Meaning, they don't have to explain anything to you. But he hit it that well every time. And he didn't seem to be swinging hard. You know, it was ridiculous. It was just really fabulous coordination on his part. Everything coming together in just such a way that it's timed exactly so there's this whip effect, cracking the whip almost like that, just at the right moment, you know, and perfect contact on the sweet spot. That's it. And some of those small short guys, they have easier time hitting the sweet spot and coordinating it all. You'd be surprised at some of these real small guys. I mean, on tour, some of the biggest hitters are like 5'7", 150. You know, it's like, what? Yeah. They have that coordination like that. It's about that sudden acceleration through, sudden acceleration, really, really perfectly timed acceleration. And we, you know, don't, we kind of clank around, don't quite have it all synced up that way. Occasionally we sync it up and we say, "Ah, what happened to that one? That was great. What happened there?" I don't know. Just everything seemed to work good. It happens too fast and you can't think about it. The more you think about it, the less it happens. The more you're thinking about how to do it, the more you get in the way, and everything gets out of whack. And then when you get out of whack, it's horrible. You can do no right. You can do no right. You can go from doing no wrong to doing no right, and then, you know, very quickly. Which is why most golfers are mental cases. You know, I said, I had it last month, and I don't know what happened to it. You just say, well, I don't know, I just got out on the right side of the bed today, kind of. But no matter what you say, you'll sell yourself out. So baseball players, they never say when they're going good, they never say why. They never think about it. And of course, the press always asks them, well, you've been playing great lately. What do you think is the key to your success? And they just say, you know what? It's just one of those things. We got no idea. You know, never try to define your success, because then you're already lost it. You've already lost it. Very true in baseball. And you can tell as soon as they start crowing and defining and say, yeah, we've done this, 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 and this is how I'm doing so well now, blah, blah. Next thing you know, they're doing terrible. So never try to define your success. Never get pulled into that trap of defining your success. So baseball players are very superstitious about that. What they really mean, they understand how the mind works, because it shows up. The small little things show up, and so they won't, you know, they will not. They don't like the press asking those questions because it messes up their minds. Basically, when it's going good, they're unconscious. They're not thinking about what they need to do to go good. As soon as they start thinking about it, they stop going good. That's it. When they're just out there having fun and letting it flow, it all feels easy for them. That's why team chemistry is so important, is people have, you know, so they feel like loose and relaxed and laughing, and nobody's asking analytical questions. They're playing pranks on one another, and they're not trying to think about how they're going to succeed. They're in a mood of enjoying what they're doing, loving what they're doing. So this is fun. I really enjoy this like a kid. This is fun. Yeah. And as soon as they start trying to press and do better, they tighten up, things go wrong. Giants, somehow the Giants are the worst team in baseball this year, have suddenly turned it around, won 6 games in a row. And the players, they just says like something, just a switch went on, and everything just completely turned around. And suddenly, we're just having fun, we're laughing, we're joking, and we're like winning, and we just feel like we can't lose. Whereas before, they said we felt like we couldn't win. There's no way we could win. Suddenly, now they just feel like we can't lose. And we said, we have no idea, you know, why this has turned around, actually. And we don't want to even know why it has. Think about it, you know? It's just one of those things that just happens. That's all. It just happens. And we're just enjoying it. That's all. So they're trying, you know, not to think about it. Of course, the press is trying to analyze it. You know, analyze this, you know, da 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 da. But I haven't been following them, and I just checked in at the kind of the midpoint of the season. And when they got this, brought this pitcher up, I said, you know what? Their season's going to turn around. This is it. This is the key move. And it's turned out to be that way. I just had this feeling. I said, this guy is going to change the mood of the team somehow. He's just going to give them this little confidence in the middle innings. Like, we don't have to worry about that anymore. We can relax. Sort of middle reliever, which they didn't have any success with. And I said, watch, watch. This is going to just tweak the team in just the right way. And they're going to kind of say, you know what? Maybe if we play well, we got a chance to win now. Before, they didn't have a chance. So, and tweak things, it tipped things, and it's now dominoing effect. Now they're like very, very full of swagger and confidence. Yeah, it's amazing. Baseball is very, very tough to predict the ups and downs. It's really quite astonishing. Teams can get really hot, and then they can just go really cold. You don't know what to expect, actually. Tremendously mental game, and a game of confidence, and trusting all your teammates, and just trusting in the outcome, and not trying to force anything, and just feeling like, you know, you're just in the now. You have to be really in the now, in the moment, and feel okay about being in the moment, and trusting it'll work out for you that way. Because when you're trying to hit 100 mile an hour fastball, you know, whatever, you know, if you're not in the moment, you know, and enjoying the moment and slowing everything down that way, the game goes too fast for you. Goes too fast for you. Next thing you know, the game's on top of you, you know, burying you. You get buried. So the team is really loose and relaxed and in the now, and not trying to think about any future results or past anything, and just goofing off and smiling and say, you know what, I just love being here. I just feel like in a winning mood, you know. I feel like I can do no wrong. then everything slows down for them. That can come and that can go, but we're working on is that we don't want the going part to doesn't need to arise anymore, because we now realize that that's actually our just belief in unfixating something. So we don't want to unfixate realization, right? So we got to get over that habit. So we got, you know, we're so used to unfixating everything to try and prove to God we fixated something, that when we get realization that nothing's ever been fixated, we don't want to undo that realization, right? We don't want to say, oh, I'm fixated now on no fixation ever happened, so let me unfixate that, you know, prove to God that that I did fixate it in the first place. See, that is absurdity, but that's the habit takes over, doesn't it? You might experience this. I've experienced it a number of times. Get becoming more and more now that, you know, the mandala consciousness, if we can call it. It's a nice term. I don't think people have been using that term very much at all. Anyone? Mandala consciousness. And then what do? I say, okay, I need to unfixate this, you know. Oh, yeah, God, you know, I got to prove to God, you know, that I can unfixate this too. That'll really prove to God that I can fixate the mind. It's just a habit comes up of unfixating, of dying. So we're used to dying to everything, aren't we? Unfixating everything. But we don't want to unfixate our realization that that fixation is impossible, because then we're just plunging into absurdity at that point. And again, don't chase after results. Don't chase after results here. We've just recognized something that's very wowish indeed. But because we didn't chase after results. You see, we stayed loose, we stayed relaxed, we're joking, we're laughing. We're not chasing after results. We feel we're winners, you know. We're definitely winners. Are you kidding? So why should we be frantically chasing after results? Whatever results we need are bound to come, right? So you see how we talked about golf, baseball, blah, blah, chatting, laughing, and then here comes this fabulous recognition. Just came along, we said, okay, great. Don't chase after results. Don't try to do anything to put it, define it, except wow. We've already got the definition, so we don't need to go chasing after any definitions. It's just wow, that's all. Perfect, absolutely perfect. What time is it? Okay, the timing on this is perfect too, on this video. Whew, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Staying with my 6-to-6 diet is extremely helpful, because we're always tempted to eat too much at any given point. But if you just say, look, I can't eat anything after 6, then that's it. So I ate at 4:40. I ate too much macaroni salad. I said, oh, I'm going to gain weight. Well, but I'm not eating anything more until tomorrow morning. So that helps keep it in check, you see. It helps keep that snacking habit in check. And that's what really causes us problems, is too much snacking. Especially if you have something very tasty. For me, I start eating, you know, going back again and again and again and again. That's what adds up. You just have to cut it off. No food after 6 o'clock. That's a guaranteed winner. Now, am I gonna be hungry tomorrow morning? Absolutely. Good. I'll eat then. I'm not gonna die between the of starvation between now and then. I got plenty of food in my system, right? So, no worries. Little bird hopping around, they're so silent. I was hopping in the tree. You wonder what world do the birds live in, right? It must seem quite different than the world we see in many ways. We're not sure, you know, what it's like, but I'm sure it's seen in a very different way. I'm a swinging kid. Remember to stack the shoulder down. Really stack it like that. And that really gives you then leverage to swing hard with the irons. Stacking the irons is important. Swinging really good. Swinging. Putting a feeling like that'll put a charge into the ball, which is great. That's so I'm reaching that goal. That goal. Without hurting my back. It hurt last night. I swang too much during the day without stretching. And I've been not stretching enough. That is for sure. I get lazy about that. But it seems like the back's holding up. You know, nothing bad is happening to it. I'm strong enough. Just the muscles got sore. But I really should start. I'm gonna have to start stretching again. I think I have to. Yeah. Otherwise, I may cause problems. So it's just stretching time now, I guess. Yoga time, yoga stretching time. Power's there. Okay, the power is there. Now it's just to make sure I don't get hurt. There you go. So I'm gonna really start stretching it out now. That's the next big thing. Still doing my push-ups. As long as we keep doing push-ups, it's fine. I did how many did I do today? I think I did 50. Or maybe, yeah, at least 50, maybe 60. I did 40, then I did 20, so I did 60. Yeah, did 60. I think I've done it 3 consecutive days, push-ups. So that keeps, you know, a certain level of fitness going there. So, I'll do trampoline and stretching. Trampoline, stretching, trampoline, stretching. The speed and power is definitely there. So. Just goes reasonable. Say, hey, okay, then really start limbering up. Then let's go into a program of limbering up, so I don't, you know, don't hurt myself. Wow. Just like we have the insights now, so what do we do? Well, kind of limber up. What's that mean? Be relaxed. Maybe humorous. I don't know. I'll have to ask the Holy Spirit of what to do. What's the corollary, spiritual corollary of stretching and limbering up? We've done the heavy lifting now. We've done the heavy lifting, right? Yeah. We brought everything to light. So what do we do after we have done the heavy lifting? We've got the strength. So to be limber now means what? Good question. Beautiful, majestic, maybe. Focus on beautiful and majestic. Possible. Maybe limber up our experiencing of the beautiful and the majestic. Possible, huh? I think I'm going to ease off the swing, and the swing is there. So what do we do with the taping? What do we do with the taping? Well, great question. Just sit here and we'll ask the Holy Spirit. It's stretching time. So the corollary will be what? Corollary will be what? Well, I'll have to find out. Start some stretching, and back off the heavy swinging for now. Let the body recover, and we'll see how the taping goes. Right? Because terrific, terrific, wonderful. The new way is wow, isn't it? It really is. The new way is wow. The new way is wow.